So the first question I wanted to ask you is, what is Robert like?
Okay, growing up with Robert, like I said, he was born February 2nd, 2004. Special baby. He shot out like a football, so I always thought that he was going to be a football player just because of that. But he's always been like happy, just always happy in the beginning, loving, caring, protective. He cared about his family a lot because he's the youngest of four. So he always gave respect to his older brothers and stuff like that. He always knew his place as a younger brother. So like he just always wanted to be around men. Like he's a man's man. So he just like having fun. He like anime. He enjoyed hanging out with his friends, hanging out with his brothers, going shopping. Hanging at the park, he was very spiritual. He loved talking about the Anunnaki and stuff like that. Like, so he was always on a whole other level. Like, so.
Growing up, he was a good kid. Like, he was always playful. He didn't really get into too much. Like, you know, like my mom said, he was always laughing. He always wanted to be around his family. So it was his friends that kind of encouraged, I guess, more so like street behavior. But it was more so like, and at least from my perspective, I felt like he wanted to change his friends too. Cause that's the type of person he is. Like he always wanted to change the people he was around or make people better. So it was like, you know, his friends didn't have the best lifestyle. So he would try to get them to like get jobs or, you know, try to talk them out of being in the streets.
I would describe him as open-minded. He likes to always look for something new. Like he was never set on anything, like a set goal. He always wants to learn everything, basically. So he was always open-minded with everything.
He had a thousand questions.
As growing up, we was always together. He was always just me and him. I was always taking wherever I went. Went to the same schools. So.
Motivation High School.
Yeah, helped him get into high school. And then, like I said, after I graduated, that's when he probably got like a little different. Not like, to me, he stayed the same. Only thing that happened was he started losing friends. And then, well, it's hard for everybody. Mm-hmm. He lost so many, like, back to back. It wasn't like a span where he could have grieved a good amount of time.
Yeah.
It was like simultaneously. So I know that was a big thing that was always his biggest problem. And we didn't know anything about like him doing other drugs that we had found out like probably a year into everything happening, 2 years into everything happening. But how he is as a person, to me, he's just the same. I don't really think he's any different. Only thing that was different was he just had got randomly violent. That was all. That was not him.
Let's do something right.
Like he always stood up for himself or, you know, defend himself like anybody else, but it was always more provoked. He was more provoking. And he's looking for violence, basically. And that's, you know, I know that's usually not who he is. Robert's caring. He is caring. He's smart and everything. And if he was to have $1 million, he'll make sure that everyone will have something as well.
Hey, he's very generous.
He is. He's a family-oriented type of man. Gotcha.
He always had a thing for like numbers and science. Like when he was younger, he wanted to be a scientist. That's all he ever talked about. When he grew up, he wanted to be a scientist. But as everything, things happened. He got older. He met the wrong people. And he got hooked on drugs that he was supposed to get hooked on in early life. So it's just like, I really wish that he was able to still pursue his, you know, dreams of becoming a scientist and stuff like that. But I don't see, you know, if that's going to happen anytime soon because he got to spend the next 15, 30 years in prison. But he is, like I said, always going to be that loving, caring, protective child to me. So that's who Robert Davis is to me. Somebody who loves his family and who always wanted to protect his
family. He's a very good person, even though he's, you know, portrayed as this murderer, portrayed as this guy who took out some, you know, some activists, some LGBTQ, some you know, black angry man or whatever the case may be when the media. But this is a person who's been through a lot of trauma, a lot of pain, a lot of suffering, and been on their own.
What is your understanding of what happened to Robert and what transpired in October?
My name isn't important, but the story I will share with you is. Today I will share with you the story of a young person who deserves our support. His name is Robert Davis. Robert Davis is a victim of sexual abuse who was sentenced to 15 to 30 years in prison for defending himself. The man accused of abusing him was named Josh Krueger. This month, I went to South Philly to conduct interviews with his family. They wanted to tell a story that is not easy to tell, but they felt that it had to be shared.
My understanding what happened is he was sexually abused by somebody who he thought was a friend, who, you know, had his best interest in hand. But it turned out to be that this person used him and manipulated him and drugged him at an early age, whereas though he would hooky school just to be with this person. He would lie to his family just to be with this person. He'd get drugs and stuff off this person. I understand, my understanding of what happened is that this man, you know, was trying to blackmail him with the evidence he had on him, because I guess he was recording them every time he would get him higher or whatever. I guess he would record them without his knowing. And, you know, he said he was going to use those images to upload on the internet. You know, if my son didn't do these activities, these sexual activities that Josh wanted to do. Josh wanted to do something with animals. And my son loved animals, so he was not with any of that. So he said, you know, once he said that he was gonna upload images of him, sexual images, explicit images of him online, he kind of like blacked out. And that's, you know, what initially triggered him to shoot him 4 or 5 times in the abdomen, which he regrets to this day.
Do you think that Robert understood that blackmailing with revenge porn or posting any type of revenge porn is something that is illegal, that's something that, you know, abusive people do?
No.
Do you
think he didn't know that?
Gotcha.
He didn't know that. And this is why I'm kind of like low-key upset, because if he would have came home and let us know that this person was trying to do stuff like that, we would have handled it the legal way.
Right.
He didn't do that. And like I said, at that time, unfortunately, I was in Miami. And I had been in Miami for like the last year and a half prior to all of this taking place. So
gotcha.
He was really here with his brothers when all of this transpired.
So while filming this documentary, I got the great chance to consult a suicidologist and a counselor by the name of Araya Baker. They gave me some great information, and I want to tell you some of the questions that I asked. The first question: at what age is someone fully an adult, given all the recent findings? This was their answer. While the age at which someone becomes an adult is a subjective perception, it is a fact that the brain is not fully developed until age 25. Until that point, the brain region responsible for introspection, self-regulation, and social judgment is underdeveloped. This means that the manipulation tactics of a groomer may go over the head of a 24-year-old who looks like a fully developed adult. Yet the 24-year-old may trust in and even defend that groomer because the flattery showed on them is a distraction from grappling with identity development concerns without adequate coping strategies. In some instances, the attention groomers offer is more consistent and positive than the attention young targets receive from anybody else, even family.
This is alarming not only because teen and young adults are often easily influenced and highly impressionable, but also because grooming starts with flattery, but eventually devolves into abuse. One study of child sexual abuse survivors found that grooming was traumatic in and of itself, aside from the impact of rape or specific acts of sexual assault. Ms. D'Amica talked about how Robert felt bad about what he'd done. When I spoke to Robert, he said the same things to me. And I can't help but to think about that burden. To go through the things that he reported as an adolescent and be expected to make the right decisions. He is legally an adult, but he is still developing as a 20-year-old. And none of that feels right. Robert also experiences suicidal ideation while in prison. And he experiences depression as well. He expressed this in a letter to his mom. Limited communication with loved ones has been tough on Robert. And how can a young person heal in that environment? It all seems so unfair. Robert ended his last letter with his mom explaining that he's not giving up, just hurting. What do you know about the content found in Josh Kruger's phone?
Okay, from my understanding, from what Robert's lawyers said, you know, that it was a massive amount of evidence found in his phone, his home, and all over his social media sites, where he targeted multiple children in the Philadelphia area, soliciting sex, you know, soliciting money, sex, trying to get them to come to his house and do, you know, do things for money. So as far as my understanding is, they found evidence of him doing things with animals in his phone. And that was like one of the things that I wanted them to pretty much like hone in on more of, because that was like a big deal to me, because that was like one of the reasons why he was murdered. Mm-hmm. So you would think that they would at least slide that in the news media, because that was a major part of what caused his demise. But yeah, that's pretty much.
How many people reached out to you and expressed that they were targeted by Josh?
Okay, me personally, about 4 people just in this neighborhood reached out to me about Josh either targeting them or their nephews, and they had to go check them. But my son and his friend, they're like I said, they're in the LGBT community, so they're on a lot of the websites that he was frequent on. So he reached out to them a couple times, and a couple people reached out to them after they found out about what happened, and they let them know that Josh was, they knew who Josh was, and they, you know, they feel sorry. They send their condolences and stuff like that. So I would say about, in total, about maybe 6 or 7 people reached out so far about their contact with Josh Kruger and how they feel bad for us, what we're going through, because they know what kind of person he was.
That's horrible. I didn't know there was that many people.
Yeah.
But also not surprised, because it's somebody
and
who does
and that's
that.
Why I wanted to speak about more, because I know, I can guarantee you it's a whole lot more. Mm-hmm. What they found in that man's phone was more, but instead of addressing the names and stuff that they found in this man's mm-hmm. phone, they don't want to address it. See, that's what we have a problem with. Because these are kids, you should have let their parents know that they were in this man's phone, and they didn't do that. As the district attorney of Philadelphia.
Josh Kruger had popularity in the city, and him being white definitely affected how this story was reported. During the hearing, were the allegations acknowledged at all? Were they acknowledged enough for you? Or?
The allegations were not acknowledged at all. Not once did they acknowledge anything
the entire
that they
hearing?
Found in this, not during the hearing, not during the media, put nothing. Then that's where I have a problem at. That's where a lot of people have a problem, because a lot of people want to know what they found in this man's phone, but they don't want to discuss anything that they found in this man's phone. And we should all be curious and wonder why. What's the big secret? what's in his phone. If it's just children, then he was contacting the community, and it's no one else affiliated with it, why is it a big deal? Let these parents know what their children were involved in.
Mm-hmm.
You know, who was harming their child anyway. Like I said, but he got contacts. Like I said, he was part of the health department. He was part of the mayor's office. He was a part of this program, this COVID-19 program that received over $34.5 million in federal funding that, you know, that provides housing and rental assistance and stuff like that to HIV patients in the community. So you would think that they would have at least spoke on that. They didn't even do that. It's like, you gotta ask yourself, why didn't they speak on that? Especially a figure like that, you would think that they would address that he was involved in sexual assault in a minor, multiple minors, but no, nothing at all.
I do not believe that Josh Krueger is the victim in this story. How could he be when we look at the countless accusations, from child endangerment to manipulation, to revenge porn, to blackmail, to drugging, to sexual abuse, and animal abuse, and mental abuse, to grooming, and preying, and exploitation, and coercion, and abuse of power, and an abuse of resources, and even in death, his privilege protects him. The pleasure of speaking to Robert while visiting his mother's house. Robert was very empathetic, reflective, and he seemed to have a better idea of what he went through. I asked Robert the ways in which the abuse affected him, and this was his answer.
Abuse affected me in more ways than one. He, like, I thought, like, we were, like, I'm not sure how to put it, like, I thought we were like friends. I thought we was like, we were closer than what we really was. Like, then I started to realize in his mind, I wasn't really like, he wasn't even looking at me as a friend, he was just looking at me.
Somebody he can get something out of, somebody he can abuse.
I kind of like, I look at him as like, one of my best friends. And it wasn't even like that, like, as far as like how he treated me, and like it was bad. I thought we had like a good friendship thing going on, but really I realized I was just being used.
Got you.
And I feel shameful about it. The blame I put on myself,
like,
before it even got bad, like, it got really bad, I should have told somebody. I just didn't want nobody to know. So I put myself in a bad predicament. And like, once I knew what type of person he was. And I know what type of person he was for a little while before everything happened, but I just didn't want to say nothing about it. I thought I could just leave him alone, and it wouldn't make that easy for me.
How did the abuse affect Robert?
From my perspective, like I said, because I didn't really understand at that time, those years that we was dealing with Robert, that it was drugs that was affecting him. I thought that he was going through depression. And we dealt with him according to that. We thought that because of him not having his biological father and his, you know, his brother's father, because that's who pretty much raised him, his stepfather, was in his life. So I just thought that I seen that a change in his behaviors. Like I said, he really just wanted a father figure to love him, and he didn't have it. So he pretty much just like lashed out a little bit because of that. But he was, like a little conflicted because he like I said, he knew who his real father was, but his real father really wasn't too active in his life. And when he did spend time with his real father, it was like his father was like insulting him because of the clothes that he would wear, or how he would, you know, how he would dress, or how he would talk, or just his manner with everything that a father should basically do to a child. That's what his father did to him. So he pretty much, he really didn't want to have too much dealings with his biological father. He cared more about what his stepfather, you know, had to say and involvement with him. So when him and his stepfather got into an argument, an altercation, because he lived over there for about 5 years before he came over here. So he, him and his stepfather would get into altercation because of the way he would keep his house dirty. He would never clean up after himself. So that was like a big problem we had, all of us had with Robert. Like he, you know, he'd get drunk or high or whatever. He was, whatever he was doing, whatever he was involved with Josh, like I said, we didn't really know it was drugs. We thought that he was dealing with depression. So we just, you know, try to just understand and try to, you know, comfort him, because he was, one minute he was happy, one minute he was sad, you know, one minute he was crying, one minute he was angry. So we pretty much just, we never knew like what Robert we was getting. So we had to pretty much like kind of like deal with him accordingly. But his dad, like I said, his dad, we didn't know, his dad like kind of like put him out. And that's why he had came over here. So when he came over here, he didn't really have no room. So he pretty much just stayed in the room with me. So he, we talked a lot about what he was going through. And he just always expressed that he needed a father figure, somebody to teach him how to be a man. And he never had that.
When he met him, he would come by and he would, you know, tell us little stuff about who the person was, but he would never say it was Josh per se. So he would always say it was like a white woman or something like that. So, and then, you know, we didn't really question it too much because, you know, we didn't really understand at the time. So we would just leave it be. And then I would say, like, when he probably hit like 17 or 18, well, 16, 17. That's when it kind of got a little more aggressive, because that's when he would tell us, you know, he got new clothes, or he just would pop up with a, you know, certain random amount of money. Mm-hmm. So it was just, you know, it was very heartbreaking to see. And that's when we found out like he was doing meth, and then the meth ended up leading to cocaine. So it was just like, it was a lot of factors that went into him becoming who he ended up being. So like, you know, that was just a big thing too. And that's what led to him being angry or violent. Because like I said, I've, you know, I was a little confused as well, because I never would have expected that to happen. So, especially me being the oldest. So it was just like, damn. And I even kind of blame myself a little, because I'd be like, was I not there enough, or was I not around enough to show him something different, or did he not see how I was moving so that he would want to do it too? So it was just like, damn, like, I wish I would have been more involved, or I wish he could have been able to, felt like he could have talked to me a little more. So that was kind of like my thing too, was just, you know, kind of being disappointed in myself a little bit. And then it was, and then like later on, like when we found out who he was or had an idea who it might be, you know, it's not like we could really do anything about it, because we didn't know where he lived at, we didn't know where he would go to, we didn't know where he would be at, because he would leave late. And that was like a thing for us too. We would be like, why are you coming in the house so late? Why are you, you know, why are you out all late hours of the night? So it would just be like, and then that's when a lot of the fighting started. Because he would come in maybe drunk or high. So he would come in, you know, probably talk to my mom for a little bit. You know, that's when he'd be relaxed and calm, because that was like his savior, I guess you could say. Like, he would come in, talk to her, tell her what's on his mind. And as far as we was concerned, it was just like, I guess maybe he probably couldn't trust talking to us, or, you know, I don't know what it probably was, but he didn't really talk to us like that. And that was probably the main thing, was just communication.
Yeah, so. I never, like, besides us getting to our little kerfuffles, and that was the only thing that bothered me, because I knew that it was just coming from a place of hurt. It wasn't like me and him actually had issues. I don't have issues with anybody. And now, like, I live with my family, but I have issues with my family. But it, that never really made sense. And even if afterwards, he always got up, like, he always felt bad that even happened. It's not like he...
Like, even though with all the drug use and stuff like that, he would come here and fight with his brothers. Even with all the drug use, he would still know that he was, what he did was wrong. And he would always apologize to his brothers for acting the way they did.
Yeah, we would take our couple of days and, like, cool off, because, you know, how people just need their time. And then we would just bounce right back to the
same. My kids know what unconditional love is.
Gotcha. Yeah. I always just try to be there for him, even afterwards, everything was going on. Because he didn't think that I wanted to be there for him. But I'm like, I'm always there for him.
So there has been several issues with the reporting of this story over the last year. The first issue is, many stories fail to acknowledge that Robert is an adolescent. Some don't even mention his age. Also, several articles have said that Robert was in a relationship with Josh when he was 15. A 15-year-old cannot be in a relationship with a 35-year-old. What they should have described was abuse.
Police arrested Robert Davis, the man accused of killing journalist and activist Josh Krueger. Krueger was found shot 7 times inside his Point Breeze home October 2nd. Investigators say they have video of Davis near Krueger's home moments before the shooting. And they say Krueger and Davis were acquaintances.
Ms. D'Amica also discussed the incident on the SEPTA platform last year and how the coverage of that was not very fair either.
They were charging him with an incident that happened, what is it, September, is that late September? I forget the date. But they were charging him for him having a weapon, but it happened like 6 o'clock in the morning. But not knowing that when he left from around Josh's house, that was normal time that Josh would go around there 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, he'd sneak out, go around there. And he'll come home about 6, 7 o'clock in the morning. So that was like normal hours that he would leave from where he was at. So 9 times 10, come to find out, he was high off meth or something.
So when that happened,
more than likely he was high off meth coming from around this man's house after he was sexually assaulted. So you want to take that and then you want to use that against him? How about the person that caused him to get high? You're not going to charge him with anything? Like, it's like, it was crazy to me to see that y'all want to focus on this SEPTA incident and use it to add to what he did to Josh. This is like, y'all want to focus on that, but y'all don't even want to even talk about what Josh did and how many other kids he was involved with him. So I found a problem with that as well. It's like...
No, I agree. It's not giving any context to what happened, what was going on with him.
Right. You just said he came up with a gun and he's crazy. All right, well, more than likely he was high off something that he received from that man after he was just sexually, more than likely he was sexually abused. Right. So it's like, take that into consideration as well. But they didn't want to take that. They didn't want to talk about that. Because I mentioned that to them as well.
More than likely, press conference.
Yes. Yes, more than likely he was high off of something that he received from that man. Mm-hmm. But y'all just want to keep making it seem like he was just out here just going. That's what the issue is with me, because what if we had multiple Joe's Krugers in the neighborhood doing this to multiple kids at a time? These kids are out here getting high, getting sexually assaulted, and they're out here committing crimes. So what does that do? Give the police something to do. This is why the police is covering up what's going on, because they all in cahoots working together, fucking drugging our black community, our kids, our sons, getting them high, and they have my hair committing drugs, have crimes and stuff to get drugs, because this man got them on drugs, and they want to continue to get high. And the only way they can do that is if they're out here robbing and stealing and doing something that they're not supposed to be doing. They either want to end up dead or they want to end up in jail.
Right.
So it's like, you see where the problem is, and instead of addressing it, you want to cover it up? No, this is a problem. I see a problem. And I see where you can nip this in the bud and address all the people involved in it, especially because it's big people. This is, you talk about $34.5 million. So what is a person like that with control of that kind of money doing living right around the corner in my community? Ask yourself that question. Like, you can't tell me that this ain't part of y'all program and y'all using the funds from this program to buy all these kids all these expensive gifts. Track about where he was spending all his money. My son was coming home with $800 fucking Hermes belts. But Louis Vuitton's like, he come home with all this expensive shit. It's like, who's paying for this? Where are you getting this? Oh, this woman. Okay, so that means it's a track record. She used a credit card. Find out where those gifts. You can't tell me that he wasn't using those funds for the wrong purposes. And y'all don't want to look into that? Y'all don't see no reason for no investigation? Like, that's where I have a problem at. It's like, y'all want to keep focus on the black boy killing this white man, but y'all don't want to focus on this $34 million that this man was in control of, and he in our community? Why is he in our community is a question. First of all, my son said that this man had a female counterpart that he was working with. So that means it's a male and a female out here doing what Josh was doing. I just want the community to be aware of what's taking place, and we gotta watch our children. Because like I said, I didn't know. So like I said, we are everybody in my, we smoke weed, so it's like, you cocaine, crack, meth, all that shit was foreign to us. We don't know. Yeah. So to find out you doing stuff like that, it's like, why? Who the hell are you involved with that you doing stuff like that? We don't. That ain't over here. Where you seeing this kind of activity? That?
I got the chance to ask Araya some ways that trauma from sexual abuse and assault can affect a teenager. This was their answer. There is consensus among researchers from numerous disciplines, including but not limited to child welfare, counseling, education, and public health, about the severe and long-lasting trauma that can result from sexual violation during teenage years. Sexual violation may increase the teen's risk of suicidal ideation, self-harm, post-traumatic stress disorder, anxiety, depression, substance abuse, and eating disorders. Symptoms such as poor sleep, appetite changes, panic attacks, and overwhelming feelings of helplessness are common. These symptoms can cause family tension, social alienation, or withdrawal, and they can also cause disruption of school attendance or academic focus. The impact of sexual violation on teens is consuming and insidious because the brain region responsible for higher-level decision-making, emotional processing, and self-reflection is underdeveloped. Until these higher order cognitive capacities emerge, teens can have an unstable self-concept. Their self-worth can be fleeting, and identity development process can cause a lot of angst and despair. Unfortunately, all of this suggests that the impact of sexual violation may be even more amplified for teens and young adults who are multiply minoritized, such as queer and trans black youth.
Every part of me is a vision of a portrait of Mona, Mona Lisa. Oh, every part of me is beautiful, and I finally see I'm a work of art.
In our conversations, you said that you and Robert want to keep this from happening to other young people. How do you plan to do that?
Basically, sharing his story and sharing what we as a family experienced within the last 7 years. And if we can share our story and help other people be aware of the what to look for, you know, as far as drug abuse, you know, mental abuse, sexual abuse, like, if, because he actually went from being a happy, loving, free child to somebody who was very secretive. He didn't want to, you know, us looking at his phone, and he got real secretive. So it's like, so if we can help another family or another child not have to go through what we went through, that's what the goal is. You know? So we got to the point where we started like following him. We would let him go out. He would go out 12, 1 o'clock. That was like the hours that he would always leave out the house when people meet up with this person. It was always late at night, early in the morning. So we would always like kind of like follow him and see where he would go. We would let him like go ahead of us like 5 minutes, and they would try to go out there 5 months. By the time we went out there, he would be already gone. So we'd be like, damn, what the hell did he go that damn fast? This nigga magic. Like, hold up. So we like never really could pinpoint exactly like where he was going and stuff like that in the middle of the night.
I created a petition asking for the release of Josh's phone records. The petition is also asking for a pardon for Robert Davis. Soon the petition will be sent to the Philadelphia Police, DA Larry Krasner, and Governor Shapiro. The reality is Robert may very well serve his 15 to 30 years. That doesn't mean that we cannot support Robert. Putting money on his books is supporting Robert. Listening to Robert's story is supporting Robert. And there's so many ways to lift him up. And again, this is not a story to pick up and put down. My hope for this documentary is to bring attention to Robert's story, and not just for people to sit around and talk about how unfortunate all this is. I want people to act. So very often, we look at things, we look at injustice, and we say, I wish there was something that I could do. There is.
Like, I'm trying to stay out of trouble and stuff. It's a lot of people got this. Like, a lot of people say how I look familiar, or they know who I am. They know my kids. They got this. Like, they need women in here. It gets very hard to, like, not get, like, stay out of trouble and just, like, yeah. My time will go by. Like, I feel like I'll be feeling in my life. So I told myself, I just told my dad earlier, like, I'd rather do 30 years being respected than here than 15 years being chump. I'm not trying. Like, I don't know. Like, I'm
he's
not.
A man of integrity.
It's hard.
Well, I got you. You got
he's
my
a man
dad.
Of integrity.
Got
you.
Situation, and it gives me more situations. It gives me more. It brings more situations trying to avoid it.
Ain't nobody called Pooch. No one said Pooch.
Because they know that
Pooch?
I don't want no problems.
What?
And they know that
what
I don't
want?
Want to get in any trouble to get written up.
Got you.
My first fight I got into here, I got me. The guard maced me in my first fight, and I don't want to. That kind of traumatized me. I don't want to get maced no more, man. I don't want to get maced. I don't really care about fighting, but you get written up for that. It's at least 180 days.
upstairs, my time. Upstairs.
Go to school. I didn't finish school. I got to finish school.
Go upstairs.
School, work. While I'm in here, I get paid for that. I just want to do that and get my time.
Gotcha.
Get out of the minimum.
I did want to ask, we talked about this a little bit earlier, like what type of support you feel you need right now? Like what type of support do you want from other people at this moment? What type of support do you feel Robert needs?
Okay, right from his words, right now he needs a little financial support. He needs mental support as far as people, you know, calling him or writing him letters, anything to that extent, whereas though he has something to read, look at, want to send pictures, whatever. Stuff like that is what he needs right now. And that's pretty much basic needs for him at this moment. Just making sure he got money on his books and he got money so he can make phone calls and he can receive letters and stuff like that from people that actually care about him.
What support do you think he needs in the long run, if you can?
In the long run, he's going to need mental support because I really believe that dealing with his mental is very important because he didn't get a chance to grow fully and learn everything that he needed to learn. Like he said, like he was saying, he don't even know how to drive and he's sitting in jail for 30 years. So basics is what he's going to need.
Mm-hmm. I asked Araya, what does the healing process look like for someone who has been a victim of sexual assault or abuse? This was their answer. Healing looks different for everyone, and it's not a linear process. But one integral aspect of healing for survivors of child sexual abuse is the combination of community support and self-validation. And I feel that Robert deserves both.
And I love him daily. I love him more than he will ever know. Yeah.